pleasure to be out here again. I was here a couple of years ago for Horticulture Night. Had an opportunity to present at that, and we enjoy coming out to that every once in a while. I think it's a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful garden out here in west central Minnesota that a lot of people in the Twin Cities metro area don't even have a clue exists. So I'm always trying to push people, drive out to Morris. It's not that far. It only took us 2.5 hours to get to come tonight. We started a little early tonight so that we can make the drive back home yet this evening and try to get home at a reasonably civil hour. So I'm going to move through the next hour, so I'm going to move through and talk about a really kind of a whole range of herbaceous plant material. And really the focus of this talk, when it was originally put together, was to kind of feature some of the best herbaceous plant for us here in the far north. This is not comprehensive by any stretch of the imagination, so you're only going to see a little bit of my personal bias, but I've also tried to integrate, and we'll talk a little bit about some of the newer stuff that's coming in, because there's always that great interest in new perennials, and everybody always wants the newest of the new, and I always tell people, be cautious, because a lot of the stuff, we don't know a lot about performance in the far north yet. So I'm going to talk about some stuff that I think we know enough about now to know that these are going to be reasonably good performers for us here. At least from my experience in the Twin Cities area, it's a little bit different world out here again than it is in the Twin Cities. But I think most everything I'm going to talk about tonight should translate pretty relatively well for you folks out here as well. So we'll talk a little bit about culture and care and some of those kind of things in terms of selecting plants for the gardens. We're going to touch on really all kinds of different bases. So we're going to move through this really on a seasonal kind of basis. So we're going to start in spring, we're going to end up in fall. And of course, the idea with the perennials is really to be able to do that, to get that constantly changing show of bloom as we progress through the season. I think that's the fun part about working with that group of plants. Whereas with annuals, and I'm nothing against annuals, but with annuals, we plant what we choose this spring or this season. It's there for the summer. And we capture that for the whole growing season, and then it's gone, the next year we change. With perennials, we can have that change on a weekly or bi-weekly basis. So that one pocket of the garden is in flower for a few weeks, it goes away, another pocket picks up and carries on, and that constantly changes through the season. And to me, that's the beauty of growing this group of plants, is that you do have that constantly changing display that necessitates that you select plants very carefully. To accomplish those kinds of things, and we'll talk a little bit about combinations as we go through this as well. So we're going to start here with spring. Start with an oldie but a goodie. You know, this plant, by the way, Dicentra, all the gory plant names are there for you on the screen. Current taxonomy, Dicentra no longer exists. We got a new genus, so you can do what you want with that. Now, Latinocarpus is a new genus now, but this is a common old-fashioned bleeding heart native to Asia. It's been cultured and grown in gardens for hundreds and hundreds of years, and it's still a great plant in its own right. And we were always amazed when we were in the nursery business. We were in the perennial nursery business for almost 30 years before we retired. And we're always amazed every year how many bleeding hearts you can sell to people, even though it's common, it's around, but everybody always loves bleeding. So there is some fun, interesting new stuff coming in that genus, and this would be one example of that. This is a plant that's been out in the trade now for a couple of years called Valentine. It's sold under its trademark name, Valentine. And it grows just like common old-fashioned bleeding heart, 2 to 3 feet tall, 2 to 3 feet across. But it doesn't have those light pink flowers. It's got these deep, deep rosy red flowers. So if you put the two of those on the far end of the room and when they're in flower, this one will stand out much better just because of the intensity of the flower color. So it's just a little bit different twist on as I say, an old-fashioned, well-known plant that's been around for a long, long time. People sometimes get a little bit frustrated with this plant because it goes sometimes in certain situations it shuts down or goes dormant early before the frost comes in the fall. That usually is tied to culture. If you want to know the kind of conditions your plant needs to grow in, study it in its native habitat. Where does Dicentra, if you will, spectabilis grow in the wild? In Asia, lightly shaded, very evenly moist soils. So if we put it in full sun, we drought stress it, it's going to shut down early. If we grow it under the right culture, we should have foliage right up until the frost takes it down the fall of the year. So some of those kind of cultural things I think are really, really important to keep in mind in terms of when you're selecting plants for specific locations and whether it's the right plant or not, and that would just be an example of that. So that's just one example of something new there. You probably all have seen our native Jacob's Ladder. Grows. It's a native woodland wildflower forest here. Plain green foliage, not this color foliage. This is obviously a variegated selection of that. Our Jacob's Ladder in our garden at our home is just sending up its flower stalks now. So that typically blooms for us in the month of May. But it's a plant that has great, great foliar characteristics, whether it's the plain green foliage version or one of two variegated foliage versions. This is one called Stairway to Heaven. Another one you'll find available that's very similar to it is another variety called Touch of Class. Both are these nice quality variegations, and probably in my mind, probably one of the top five perennials for the shade garden for us here in the far north. No question about it. When this thing comes up in spring, and it's just emerging from the ground now, when it comes up, the emerging shoots are bright iridescent pink. You'll see it across the way, and you wonder, what the heck is coming up over there? Well, it's that. And if you look carefully at some of the leaf edges, like here, see a little tinge of pink there even at this point yet. As we've progressed into the season, we've got mature foliage. That some of that pink sometimes stays on the leaf edges, again, very much tied to setting in the garden. Higher light situations, some of that pink will stay. More shady situations, it will not stay. But the white variegation with the green is persistent through the entire season. So not only do you have this plant that blooms in the month of May with those kind of those bluish flowers that you see there as it's in flower there, we've got interesting foliage as it emerges from the ground. We've got a nice show of blooms in springtime. Then we've got this great foliage that's there right through the rest of the season. And if you garden in the shade, you understand the value of those kind of foliages. Because actually shade gardening is really more about foliage colors and textures than it is anything. Not to say we'll talk about some other plants here. We already looked at bleeding heart. There's certainly a fair range of flowering plants for the shade. However, most of those are geared to produce the show of flowers fairly early in the season. They evolved in situations to flower, to set seed, and before the tree canopy be closed in. So we can find a ton of flowers to bloom in the shade in spring. It's a little bit more challenging as we get into summer, and it's really challenging when you get into fall. But there are some great fall things as well. So we have to be looking to many of these kind of plants for the shade with those great foliar characteristics that we can do other combinations with other blooming plants, other foliages, some of those kind of things. But certainly, actually, one of the very, very best perennials for us for the shade garden. There's been a lot of interest in Baptisias or false indigos in the last couple decades. A couple of very prominent breeding programs in these in a couple different places in the country, which we'll talk about. This is not a new one. This has been around a number of years, so it's not widely sold. It's one called Purple Smoke. One of the parents of this plant is the common blue false indigo that many of us grow in our gardens, Baptisia australis. That's one of the parents of this one. The other one is a eastern U.S. Native species called Alba. All the Baptisias are native in this country. We have a couple species native on our prairies here in Minnesota, but the predominance of the native ones is as we go farther south, particularly into the south central plains, we'll find a lot of native Baptisia down there, many of which grow just fine for us here in the far north. No problems. This is a workhorse group of perennials because it's grows in a wide range of light situations, grows in a wide range of soils. We can grow light soils, we can grow heavy soils. They love to be left alone, undisturbed for years. So if you're not into digging and dividing perennials and want stuff that's permanent, it's going to be there for decades and decades and decades, this is right in there with your peonies. So these Baptisias, I think, are really tough workhorse kind of plants. The problem with some like this is they're big, and they take up a lot of space. Now, you guys have a lot of space out here, so it's maybe not an issue for you. When we get into urban gardening situations with smaller lots, a plant like this that can be 4 to 5 feet tall and 4 to 5 feet across eats up a lot of space real quickly. So to kind of help remedy that, there is a series that's in the trade now called the Decadent series. This is an interesting series of Baptisias because it traces its origins actually back to Minnesota. The breeder on this is a guy by the name of Hans Hansen. Some of you may recognize Hans. His name, Hans, worked for a number of years for Shady Oaks Nurseries in Waseca before Shady Oaks went away. And he was a tissue culture guy there, and he also has had a real keen interest in breeding plants. So in his home garden, he started breeding these Baptisias. That Hans has now moved on and is the head of all plant breeding at Walters Gardens in Michigan. Walters is the largest perennial grower in the United States, wholesale grower, probably several thousand acres of perennials, big time operation. And Hans is now doing all the plant breeding for them and has continued this work as he made the move over to Walters. So these are all out of his breeding efforts, and what the difference with these is a couple things. These by nature are shorter plants, probably most of them in the 2.5 to 3 foot tall range with a similar kind of spread. So they're not going to be the great big giant ones that are going to take up a space like this. So they're much smaller, but very good bloomers and a really interesting range of colors. I think there's actually 7 in the series now. I'm only showing four of the varieties here. Blueberry Sunny, Cherries Jubilee, Dutch Chocolate, and Lemon Meringue. Who doesn't want to buy those with those great names? And that's a big part about selling plants is having the right name on it. But anything with food is always popular. So same kind of growth as the tall ones. I mean, tough, durable, long-term plants. And so depending upon the situation, you have some options. Big bold and brassy, or shorter, stocky, and going to take up less space. And so this is a very significant and important group of plants for us here. And the other breeding program that maybe I should mention is at Chicago Botanic Garden. Dr. Jim Alt at Chicago Botanic Garden has been breeding with these and has introduced a couple of really, really nice hybrids out of his program. Most of those are on the big side again, but they are just absolutely rock solid performers for us here in the far north. So some of them actually originated, and a lot of them originated here in the north. Perennial sages or salvias. This is a really big group of plants. A lot of the salvias or sages are not reliably winter hardy for us here. We grow many of those as annuals in our summer containers and bedding displays and some of those kind of things. If you want something that's perennial, you have to go into the salvia nemorosa types. All the nemorosa types. And there are a range of cultivars there, and there's a lot of breeding work going on in these as well. The thing you have to remember if you want permanence and longevity out of this group of plants is full sun and good drainage in the wintertime. So if you garden on a poorly drained, heavy clay soil that holds a lot of moisture through the winter, these may be fairly short-term plants for you. On the other hand, if you're on a lighter soil or you amend your soil so that you get free movement of water through the soil profile, many of these will give us really long-term good performance as well. So the nemorosa types are the really ones we have to key in on. And I put this one in here. This is one called Viola Closi, and actually came out of Germany, as you might guess by the name. Up until maybe 2-3 years ago, this was absolutely the largest flowered hardy sage for us. And because it had such large blooms, its display of flowers was so much more prolific. a couple that have come out in the last 2 or 3 years that rival this in plant size, so getting some other big farmers as well. These, as we know, we look to them for bloom primarily late spring, early summer. So for us in this part of the world, it's often mid to late May, blooming for probably 4 to 6 weeks, especially if you go in and deadhead regularly and remove spent flowers. So we get a fairly good display of bloom out of them. If you are the type of gardener who wants to spend some time with the plant and remove individual flower spikes, you can actually, in most years, we can keep this thing flowering into the summer. So we can get, by proper plant management, we can get months of color out of this. If you don't want to do that, let it flower its initial bloom of 4 to 6 weeks, and if you looked at that point, at the end of that, if you looked down at the base of the clump, you're going to see it emerge. Typically, you'll see a new foliage mound starting to emerge at the base. Whack it off at the ground, take everything away, let it regrow, and you'll get a display of flowers later in the season as well. So you can get two bloom periods out of it, or if you're a good gardener and you deadhead regularly, you can keep it growing almost, as I say, almost all summer. But the real key with these to remember is, it's one of those perennials that likes to grow lean and mean. Hot, dry, really tough situations is what this thing really thrives on. And the winter drainage, if there's a problem, it's usually tied, in terms of longevity, it's usually tied to poor winter drainage. So you do have a lot of options to go with the nest, from some like Viola Closia that can stand almost 30 inches tall, to other forms, modern forms, recent hybrids that are no taller than 10 to 12 inches. You got a wide range of heights, you got a wide range of colors, from blues to purples to pinks to whites as well. So there's just some other flower colors available in them as well. And you can talk about, we've already talked about Baptisias in terms of equating them with peonies, in terms of long-term performance. They're going to be with you for decades and decades, and you don't have to do anything with them. Very true. Two points really to make here with you tonight is to get you to think and start looking. If you haven't already done this, start looking at what the true hybrid peonies. Most of us grow what are called the old lactiflores. Lactiflora is a species, and many cultivar selections have been made out of that. Now, the true hybrids often have lactiflora as one of their parents, but also have some other peony species involved in their breeding background. The advantage to these over the old lactifloras, in a general sense, not always true, but in a general sense, the advantages are that with the true hybrids, you get much, much better foliar qualities. If you grow any of the old lactifloras, you know that some of them have good foliar qualities, and some of them look abysmal by late summer, to the point where you just want to cut them off. Not the case with these. In fact, look at this foliage. This deep, lustrous green foliage on it. Great foliage stays all summer long. So that's one of the advantages to these. In general, very good stem strength. I'm not going to go so far as to say you never have to stake a hybrid peony, because that's not true. But many of them have such thick, strong stems that they do not need artificial support. That's a plus, I think, in most gardeners' eyes. And then the third thing that sets them apart from the old lactifloras are much deeper, more intense flower colors. And so we're looking just at two of them here, Coral Charm, and you can see with Coral Charm, when it's opening the color, and as it ages, it goes almost pure white. So it goes through a really interesting transition to color, and then Hall of Fame on the right side, there's still the new ones as well. So if you haven't looked at these, look at them. I will tell you, it's gonna cost you a little bit more, because true hybrids are slower to propagate than the old lactifloras. You might have to spend $5 or $10 more on a plant. To me, the trade-off in terms of garden performance, no question I can spend the money. Now the next group, you may not want to spend the money on. this group are what we call the Edo hybrids or the intersectional peonies. These are crosses between woody tree peonies. Tree peonies are nothing more than a woody shrub. And that can be challenging for us this far north, because in order to get flowering on tree peonies, we have to be able to the flower buds are set on the stems. The fall of the year, you have to be able to overwinter those flower buds successfully if you're going to get bloom the next spring. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. Depends upon which tree peony it is. Sometimes we have to protect them. Most people don't want to do that. So what we have here is by crossing those woodies with an herbaceous peony, what you really end up with is, in terms of foliage, looks very much like a tree peony foliage. The flower, again, looks very much like a tree peony flower. They're more that crepe papery kind of blooms to them. But we have a plant that's almost totally herbaceous in nature. These will usually die to within a couple inches of the ground. So you don't have to worry about trying to overwinter any of that stem tissue. And most of the early breeding work on these was done by Roger Anderson in Fort Atkinson, Wisconsin. Barcella was one of his very first introductions. Barcella's been in the marketplace for probably almost 30 years now. It typically still today sells in the $7,500 range. The newest of the new tree peonies often, when they first come on the market, often in the $300 to $500 range. Now, that will change. For years, it took a great length of time to figure out tissue culture protocols for these. To try to propagate these in the tissue culture lab, mass produce them. That's actually being done. There's a firm in Canada that's all it's doing is tree peonies in the TC lab now. That will bring the cost of these down, make them much, much more affordable. But honestly, folks, this is the future of peonies, or part of the future of peonies. This is where a lot of the breeding work is going on. Is these wide crosses, the intersection process. And so if you aren't cognizant of them, you need to be aware of them in the great, great group of plants. So, but they're gonna, right now, some of them are gonna be a little bit spindly. If I could only grow one iris in my garden, this hands down would be Siberian iris. And of course, you know that genus, you know big group of plants again. And basically you take iris and divide it into three groups. The bulbous iris, which are early blooming, Iris Danfordii, Iris Reticulata, just finishing up in my rock garden right now at home. So those are spring bloomers that come early and they go dormant for the summer. Then we get into the traditional bearded iris, which is the one that most people are enamored with, the tall beardeds and all the other categories within that. Not the easiest plant to grow. It's prone to some pest and disease problems, needs regular division, susceptible to iris borer. Not saying you shouldn't grow, but those are some of the challenges you run into with bearded iris. And then the third group are what we call the beardless iris. And Siberians would be one example in that group. And what that refers to, if you look, bearded iris has a tuft of raised hairs right there on the falls. That's the beard. Beardless iris obviously do not have that. So beardless irises encompass Siberian iris, Spurria iris, Japanese iris, Louisiana iris, and several others as well. So there's a whole range of those. Out of all those, this is by far the easiest of the beardless types to grow. And the reason why I like them so much is that they offer much better permanence and longevity in the landscape. They don't need regular division. I'm not going to say you can't get iris borer in them. You can, but it's pretty unusual to get iris borer in Siberian iris. So long-term performance aspect in a landscape situation, a lot less input has to go into these. Caesar's brother is probably the most well-known of the Siberians. Still a ton of it sold today. It's been around since the 1920s. But still a good plant. This kind of shows you, in this image, kind of what the form you might see in a species Siberian iris in the landscape. And then I want to show you what you see more in some modern Siberians. And a couple things will jump out at you really very quickly. You see the falls are not nearly as pendant as they were on Caesar's brother. Tend to be more flat-faced flowers, much wider flower parts. As you can see here, the width across here, we do run into a fair amount of ruffling on edges. We're seeing the color range expand. We're actually very, very, very close to a true orange Siberian iris now. So you'll see that kind of coming in. But the predominant colors are really blues, purples, lavenders, whites, a few good yellows as well. And then we do have these interesting central glaze colorations that show up on some of them as well. So There isn't a right or wrong here, it's kind of what the preference is, what you like. This group of plants we recognize as being, from terms of bloom period, usually come in with the bearded, the earliest of these bloom along with the tall bearded iris. The latest of the Siberians usually wrap up for us about mid-July. So it's really about 4 to 6 weeks of color, late spring and early summer. That would be very much dependent on your selecting early, mid-season, and late varieties if you want to cover that whole gap. But they are a very significant and important player, and I think absolutely the best group of iris for us here at the Far North. So. Then we're going to talk a little bit about bellflowers, campanulas or bellflowers. And again, varietal selection is really, really important with this. There are some types of bellflowers that are really destined to be put into the rock garden situation. They demand extremely good drainage. Some of them even demand what we call screed conditions. Those are not good border plants for us because we don't have the right kinds of soils and drainages for those, and they tend to be very, very short-term plants. What the border types, the ones that we can put into the average garden soils and do really well with, are particularly centered around this species called Glomerata. And this is a selection of Glomerata that's been out for a few years now, Cafrea. Just a really dwarf, compact version of that that's probably 18, 20 inches tall in flower. And look at the show of flowers on that. The old Glomeratas typically clustered their flowers right up only at the terminus of the stem. Now, if you look at these, we've got a bunch of flowers coming out of leaf axils as we go down the stem, so we have a much, much more enhanced display of flowers than we will on some of the older ones. And again, these can go in height from Freya, which is, as I say, 20 inches or so in height, or even shorter ones than that, and the standard old Glomerata can easily stand 2 to 2.5 feet tall. So you got a wide, I got a range of heights to choose from. Again, you also have a range of color, flower colors. Blues, pinks, purples, and whites being the predominant ones that you're going to see there. Bloom period for us usually is June, July on these, and so that's the kind of year, time of year we would be looking at many of these campanulas for. Some campanulas are extremely weedy and very invasive, and they will absolutely come take over your garden. So make sure you're buying and getting a clump. Unless you're looking for a mass scale ground cover, then you can use Campanula punctata or some of those kinds of species. They will take over huge areas of the garden. Most people don't want that. So make sure you're looking at the border types that are clump formers, and I think you'll have good results. Again, it's a fairly forgiving group of plants in terms of lights and soils, full sun, light shade. Tend to like organic soils that have a real even supply of moisture through the growing season. That's where you'll have the best results with them. So again, a soil that's been modified with organic matter and maybe using some type of mulch with on top of it, they're really going to be very, very favorable to growing those. So, and there are lots and lots of these. And you can find bellflowers that are 4, 5, 6 feet tall that you can grow in the garden as well. But they're like the big baptises, they may take up too much space for you, so you may or may not want them. Here's another genus that is in that workhorse class with our baptises and our peonies. And I'm going to show you just a couple examples of this. These are the Amsonias or the blue stars. And this is probably the most popular of the blue stars in the nursery trade today. It's a cultivar called Blue Ice. These are not the showiest plants in the world in flower. They don't scream out at you across the way so much. They're very, very subtle in their appearance. If you have this planted in a mass situation by several hundred, yeah, it probably would. But in the garden, the floral display, again, same time as the bellflowers kind of thing, a little bit more subdued. They all tend to have these kind of icy, steely blue kind of flower colors. One of the reasons I like this one is that it's a dwarf stature, probably 18, 24 inches tall. And it's probably one of the shorter ones in terms of flower. And what really makes this stand out is really if you look at the bud coloration here, it's that dark color, and then they open to those lighter blue flowers. You get this kind of interesting contrast between the bud color and the flower color. Great foliar characteristics. Live for decades once again. So they're just like those baptisias and stuff. They're just going to really give you great, great show flowers. So You got great foliar characteristics, you got permanence and longevity, you got fall foliage color. Great, great fall foliage color on all the MSOAs. I think the next one will probably show you that. This is a species that if you look where it grows in the wild, native, it's a central US native, Amsonia umbricae. I look it up in the literature. It's in the Ozarks, it's in Oklahoma, Arkansas, and you think, there's no way this thing's gonna grow in the far north. It goes beautifully for us here. This obviously is a big plant. This is probably a three and a half feet across with an eagle height to it as well. But, and this one has that same kind of bluish flower on it, but I don't grow this for its flowers at all. This is what I grow this for. Fall, what you can do with the fall landscape with seed heads of other perennials. Think about that with grasses. Think about that with fruiting shrubs. Some of those kind of things. To me that's equally as showy as any floral display. Those are just two examples of blue stars. There are a fair number of others that perform very well for us here in the far north as well. So I think, again, put it on your workhorse. Very tough, dependable group of plants for us here as well. Veronicas or speedwells, like bellflowers, very large, diverse group of plants. And like bellflowers, some are best in the rock garden. And we're not going to talk about those here tonight. I'm going to talk about the ones you can take out into the general landscape situation. They're going to be good performers. This one's been around for a long, long time. We grew this for many years in our nursery. It's a good little cultivar called Gilles Van Heese. And these, again, can go from dwarf ground cover types, and I'll show you that one of those in just a second, very short carpeting forms, to some that are 4 or 5 feet tall. All the speedwells have that spiky kind of floral arrangement to them. So they're nice for adding verticality to the garden. And a lot of our forms we grow in the garden are more rounded, globular shapes. So I'm always looking for some of that vertical kind of thing to contrast that a little bit. This one's obviously pink, but there's pinks, there's blues, there's whites, there's purples. There's a wide range of colors again. And in the most recent hybrids, these again are primarily, as I say, they bloom kind of the same bloom period as bellflowers, but June, July is their primary bloom period. But a lot of the modern hybrids that have come out in the last decade or so have enhanced blooming capabilities bred into them. So many of those actually will still flower in August, even into September. So by careful varietal selection, we can get months of color in this particular group as well. So you do have a number of different options to work with here. This is a great little ground covery kind of type. And this, some of the low ground covery ones really are more appropriate in the rock garden. You can use this. We actually have this at the ground cover, this at the front entry to our home. And when it's in flower, it's absolutely stunning. This came that I mentioned, Jim Ault at Chicago Botanic Garden with breeding Baptisias. This is smaller Jim Ault's work. He's breeding in other plant groups as well, and Tidal Pool was one of his selections. So this has kind of a great grayish green foliage that looks really very, very nice and very handsome through the summer months, and then in late spring, early summer gets this great display of those bright, bright blue flowers. It's actually just absolutely stunning when it's in flower. So some of those really can actually be utilized as living mulches, ground cover kinds of plants. We don't always, I think we do too much of this. We put too darn much bark down, and we put too darn much wood chips down, and et cetera, et cetera. We should be using more plant materials as our mulch. Accomplishes the same function, and it's got greater beauty than any mulch does. So some of these kinds of plants utilized as ground covers in the landscape really serve the same beneficial effects of any mulch you're gonna put down, and as I say, add a lot of beauty to the landscape as well. A lot of great North American native plants that we just don't do a good job of utilizing in the gardens. And this would be an example. I think I have this one and one other one. This is Bowman's root. Valenia, sometimes sold under the genus Portoranthus, but the correct name is Valenia trifoliata. This occurs native in eastern United States, woodland edges and meadows. What does that tell you? Partial shade to full sun. Blooms in the summer months, 2 to 3 foot tall plant, very upright kind of habit to it. Great, great foliar qualities on it. I mean, look at that wonderful green foliage, and it's there like that through the balance of the summer. And then it says covered with that little dancing, little white butterflies, kinds of flowers, running flowers. Not a particularly long bloom period, but when it's there, it's really, really pretty cool. And then when the flower petals fall off of that, the calyces of the flowers, that don't really show up in this image, are actually red. And they persist into the summer months. And when they turn to seed, the seed pods are kind of interesting on it as well. So nothing at all difficult about growing this plant. Very easy plant to grow. For whatever reason, it never got picked up and made available in a wide way in the nursery trade. That's happening now. We're seeing more and more wholesale sources that are starting to grow and produce this plant. A number of wholesale liner growers are growing this. So we're starting to see it show up at the retail level. You can grow it from seed yourself. It's easy to grow from seed if you want to as well. So it's just an example of a number of great North American natives that we really need to look at a little bit more carefully than we have in the past. Greensbills, the true geraniums, not the pelargoniums that we grow as annuals that we call geraniums. They're not geraniums at all. These are the true perennial geraniums that come back every year. Again, a big, big group of plants. There's probably easily 100 different hardy Greensbills you could grow in your garden here if you wanted to. So you understand there's a great diversity here once again. All of those hardy Greensbills are recognized for having what we call a palmate or a hand-shaped kind of leaf. They all have that. The size of it is going to vary depending upon which one it is. Some are quite small, as you can see in bloody Greensbill. Some are quite large. Some leaves and some of them can get to be this big. They're again primarily recognized as summer bloomers, but again, we have some that bloom in spring, including our native wild Greensbill. That's a woodland plant for us. We have some that bloom in fall. We grow a Polish species in our garden called Lasolianum that flowers from May. It was still blooming on Thanksgiving for us last fall. So, and it's absolutely rock solid hardy for us here. So they have, again, recognized for relatively long bloom periods, great foliar qualities. Where do you think the bloody comes from in that name? What, you know, there's nothing bloody in that image, but if you come back and you look at this plant in the fall landscape, the foliage is bright red orange. And many of the Greensbills do offer really nice fall foliage color. So if you think about that foliage color, maybe working that with fall blooming bulbs like species crocus and autumn crocus. I mean, there's so many fun things you can do to enhance and push interest in the garden deep, deep into the season with some of those foliage colors and some of those kind of things as well. Pretty typical kind of flower that you're going to see on a Greensbill, but again, a wide diversity of color. Similar kinds of colors we talked about with bellflowers and with speedwells, so that same kind of color range we're going to see in these. We can go from very short, little, more rock garden kinds of ones, again, that are probably no taller than 6 inches. We can go to some that are two to two and a half feet tall. So, as I say, there's just scores and scores of these that you can utilize in your garden, and it's a really, very, really a great, great group of credits for us here in the farm. Going to something more on the partial shade kind of thing, I'm going to show you a couple of different goldsbeards. This is an interesting plant. This is a big, tall species of goatsbeard, Sylvan goatsbeard, Ronchus aegus, that's actually native in the northern hemisphere circumpolar. So we'll find it native in this part of the country, but you can follow it all the way around the world and find it native. So this is a big, tall plant. It can go 3, 4, 5 feet tall, 3, 4 feet across. But I love it because it actually functions in the landscape very much like a shrub. In the summer landscape, this looks like a woody shrub when it's in flower and foliage. There are situations, I think, where a lot of those kinds of perennials maybe make sense to use instead of a woody shrub. We typically think about, we'd only put a woody plant there, but some situations, maybe this would even work better. And this would be an example of one of those plants that you could do that with. So, June, July bloom, white plumes, almost a stilby-like plumes of flowers. And as I say, it's absolutely tough as nails. Grow full sun, grow light shade. Just these all like a real even supply of moisture during the growing season. Go to the other end of the spectrum. This is a species native to Japan, Aranthus thuliifolius, or excuse me, Korea. And This is no taller, it bloomed no taller than 12 inches. And I would grow this if it never flowered, because it has such tremendous foliar characteristics. So look at that deep, deep green, fine textured foliage. But it does have miniature white plumes, miniature versions of what we saw in the previous one. Some of these, this plant typically is produced from seed. If you look at a seed population, there oftentimes are some that have really nice fall foliage color to them as well. So there's some real rich, interesting yellow to reddish orange fall tones show up in the foliage in some of these as well. And this plant actually has been around this country since about the mid-1960s. Was actually collected in the wild originally as an astilbe, as a new species of astilbe. And you can probably see where that came from, but taxonomically it was sorted out over the years and found that it really belongs with the goat spirit. Great, great plant for us here, absolutely rock solid hardy. And then the intermediate one is this one. This is a cross between those two. So it's a cross between that great big tall one and that short little athusifolius, and this one's called Misty Lace. Again, top five shade perennial for us here in the far, far north. This one probably 24 or 30 inches tall. So foliar characteristics intermediate between the two, but an amazing bloomer. What a nice show of flowers on it as well. So, and there are other goat spirits you can grow as well, but these are probably the three best for us here. And as a group, I think it's one of the workhorse groups of plants for us in our gardens here again. We could talk for hours about this. and how in the world you try to keep up with all the modern corybels? That's impossible, actually. when the breeding interest in this group first started, number 15 years ago or so, for a while I kept a database trying to track all these colors, and I gave up at 500. I don't know how many have been introduced over the years, but they kind of come and go. And I just want to make a couple points about color foliage corybels, and I'm not going to say a whole lot more about them, but this kind of shows you the range of some of the foliage colors and patterns that we can see in these. Some of you, if you were on the early end of that interest and you were buying some of those and got a little frustrated because they died through the winter for you, there was a reason for that. A couple reasons actually for that. Part of it was breeding background of the plants, part of it was a production thing. Both of those have really been solved. So if you buy some of these modern hybrid corybels with interesting foliages, I think you're going to have much better results than you might have had 10, 15 years ago. Because those issues really have been resolved. So, and really, when those first came, the pioneer in all those was a variety called Palace Purple. And we were just at a garden center the other day, and we still saw some Palace Purple being sold. And honestly, today, Palace Purple, there's still probably more Palace Purple sold than any other color foliage form of corybel. But this is a million times better than Palace Purple. This is Frosted Violet. It's probably my favorite dark foliage one. These are both Frosted Violet, these two here. The early ones of these, really, if you look at the show of flowers here, it's nothing you're going to write home to mom about. What we're seeing happen now in most recent breeding stuff is we've got all these great foliage colors that are out there, but we're also getting those foliage colors combined with really good displays of flowers. Flowers that are showy and do stand out. And so, foliage-wise, they're of value to us from the time they come up in spring this time of year until the snow hits them in the fall. Bloom season-wise, it's going to be primarily June, July. But this one here is one called Paris, which actually will continue to flower into the late summer period. So we're seeing better flower colors. We're seeing longer displays of flowers coming into these as well. So, this is an ever-evolving, ever-changing group of plants at this point yet. You've got a ton of great stuff to work with, and I'm not going to say a whole lot more about them because we just don't have the time. Another very significant, important workhorse group of perennials for us here in the north are the Nepetas or the Cactus. Now, these are mints, but these are not spreading mints. Where a lot of true mints will spread and take over huge areas, the Nepetas, or the catmints, are clump formers. So they're good, well-behaved mints. And I was talking to a gentleman here earlier about deer and the problem with deer in the landscape, and I said a lot of deer will stay away from a lot of things like this because it has fragrance to its foliage. They won't eat things like that, typically.
They won't eat things like that. If they're hungry enough, they'll mow anything down. So just a couple examples here, because we've seen a lot of recent introductions in this group of plants. And again, we recognize catmints as full sun, light shade, wide range of soil tolerances. So they're tough workhorse plants for us once again. This is one called Walker's Low, which actually isn't low at all. The name's a little misleading. It actually originated at the Walker's Low Garden in England. This plant actually can go almost 2 to 2.5 feet tall. And we know that we can easily get 4 to 6 weeks of bloom out of these in late spring into the summer months. And then if we shear them, when they're at the end of their bloom period, just take the head shears and just shear them back, we'll get another flush of bloom that'll come later. So we can easily get a couple flushes of blooms out of many of these catmints in the garden as well. And good foliar characteristics again. We're seeing a lot of dwarf forms coming into the trade. This is one of my favorites. It's one called Kit Kat. You can see, obviously, a much shorter plant. And I tell people I like this plant a lot because it's very well-proportioned plant. If you look at the size of the clump, the size of the foliage, and the size of the flower spikes, they all kind of seem to come together into this really nice package. So this one's probably 12, 15 inches tall, something like that. But again, very much a clump former kind of plant as well. And you can go even shorter than that if you want to. This is the primary flower color you're going to see in catmints, but there are white forms, there are pinkish forms. I wouldn't call them pink, I'd call them a little more lavender as well. So you do have some options there as well, but there's a wide range of heights for you to draw up in that group as well. That's a plant that's not very well known here and should be much, much better known. This is Calamaris incisa. Sometimes kind of an orphanage plant, sometimes called false aster. This is an aster relative native to Asia. Absolutely rock, totally solid, hardy forest here. And there are a couple of different species involved here. This one is a selection called Blue Star, which really isn't a very good name because it's really more of a lavendery tone to it. The straight species is pure white flowered form of these. But most of these have a more vertical, upright kind of habit to them. Once again, 2 to 3 feet tall, flower for weeks and weeks and weeks in the summer months. So if you like that composite kind of look, that aster kind of look that we see so much of in fall and not a lot of in summer, this would be an important group of plants for you to look at as well. And they're totally rock solid hardy for us here. Nice foliar characteristics, nice habit, and as I say, great, great show flowers on them as well. Again, hours and hours and hours you can talk about this. We're probably approaching 10,000 cultivars of hostas in commerce in this country today. How do you keep track of it? I tell people when you're looking at hostas, I'm always looking for stuff that when I see it, I want that plant I'm going to use in my garden that I recognize it. Once you've seen autumn frost, there's no other hosta that looks like autumn frost. So I'm looking for those cultivars that have those kind of distinctive characteristics that make them stand out and don't confuse you. And so these would maybe be just some examples of those. With autumn frost, cathedral windows, designer jeans with the radish stems, and actually now we have hosta hybrids that are out in the trade now today where this petiole coloration that you see here has come up into the veins, and actually I've seen some that have a purple-red flush all the way at the base of the leaf. So you're going to see some stuff that down the line, there's going to be some amazing stuff. And of course, that's going to happen with that. We've been able to breed that coloration into the leaves. We're also going to breed that coloration into flowers. So we're going to get beyond whites and lavenders and purples and hostas. We will get to reddish purple flowers, and we're not that far away from it. So lots of interesting stuff still coming on that. But my only caveat is look for these kind of things that really stand out. We all know that this is the number one shade perennial for us and always will be. The number two shade perennial for us are the astilbes. And I'm just going to show you a couple examples here today. It's my favorite astilbe for general landscape use. It's one called Delphi Lace. Delft Lace is probably gonna be about 30 inches or so in height. Love the foliage on it. Small, refined, more crisp kind of foliage. Because it comes out of a species called Crispa. That's where that foliar looks. So it's a real different foliar look than the Smitty and the Standard Scobies. Interesting stem coloration. Nice contrast between buds and open flowers. It's really just an absolute superb plant. Thing you have to remember with the Stilbies is water, 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 and more water. They hate to be drought stressed. They hate high soil temps. So I see a lot of Stilbies in full sun. They're doomed to failure in many situations unless the soil's been prepped very carefully and they're under a really good watering regime. This is a plant for light shade, where we minimize those kind of stresses on it, and we get the really nice show flowers out of it there as well. Not medium to dense shade, because you will not get good bloom there, but light shade, highly organic soils with a real even supply of moisture. And to quickly just tell you the old story relative to that. These, for years, the Germans in public horticultural displays have used masses of the Stilbies in public garden settings. They still do today. But in the early 1900s, early to mid 1900s, when these were being done in Germany, and there were not automated irrigation systems, what the old German gardeners used to do was take metal cans, 5 5-gallon buckets, poke holes in the bottom of the sides, and sink those in regular intervals throughout that display bed, and come through a couple times a day with buckets of water, and fill all those. Now, with modern irrigation, we very easily take care of that, but it just illustrates what the moisture needs of this plant is. Now, on the other hand, they do not like wet feet in the wintertime. So that's all about soil preps and getting organic content up again and getting good free movement of water through the soil profile for the dormant season. You can provide those things, you get some amazing displays of floral displays out of these in light shade. As so often happens with modern breeding efforts in the world of perennials, a lot of what's being bred and introduced is being bred not necessarily for good landscape performance, but is being bred and introduced for pot performance. So when you go to the garden center and you see that pot, that 2-gallon pot of the Stilbie Fireberry in full bloom in mid to late July, that you say, I've got to have this thing, this is amazing. So they've been bred for short stature, multiple stems, large flower heads. Sometimes that also translates into good performance in the landscape, and the Short and Sweet series is certainly, I think, an example of that, where not only are they great in the container and they suck you in and make you want to buy them, but if you do buy it, you put it in your garden at home, you got the right cultural conditions, it's gonna really give you a nice display of flowers as well. Some of these make great, great container plants for the summer landscape. Obviously, there's a challenge involved there with what you do with it for the winter. We can talk about that later if you want to. But some of them really are function very beautifully as pot plants in addition to great landscape plants as well. Lots and lots of new Stilbies coming out of Europe again as well. So, Coreopsis or tick seeds. Now, if you look at catalogs and you look at garden sets, you know there's just this huge array of tick seeds that are out there and available to you. Not all of them are reliably winter hardy for us here. And I always tell people, if you're trying to select for permanence and longevity for us here in the far north, look at things that have verticillata in their background. Verticillata is native on our prairies. It's a species native on our prairies. Obviously, very well adapted for us here. Many of those modern hybrid tick seeds that are out there, if they have poor drainage in the wintertime, like we talked about with sages, they're dead as a doornail the next spring. So some of this is tied to culture and some of those kind of things as well. But if you don't want to hassle a lot with that, look at verticillata or verticillata hybrids. Now, golden shower is not a new plant. Golden shower has been around for decades and decades, but there are some other newer ones that are out there. We've started growing one, I remember its name now, Electric Avenue. Trademark name is Mayo Clinic Flower of Hope. You'll see that showing up in the garden center. Absolutely phenomenal plant. It just bloomed. We actually bought it at a Heart Society fundraiser in flower last March.
and then it kind of did its thing, and I sheared it back, and it was flowering when the Killing Frost came and took it last fall yet, and it wintered beautifully. It's up and going this spring. So it's a verticillata type of thing. So my advice to you on those is be careful on some of those modern hybrids. If you want the sure thing, look to some of these, like Golden Shower, Zagreb, I can't even pull some of the other names out of my head right now, but there are a fair number of good ones for you to look at. But with Coreopsis, Tixies, it's really all about winter drainage. It's so important for that. Anybody in the room growing any of these green foliage forms of stackies? Nobody. You all got to get them in your gardens. We talk about workhorse, foolproof plants. This is a really unknown group of plants. Now, there are probably three or four different species involved with these green foliage ones that I'm going to show you two examples here this evening. And these are European natives, but they're the same plant genus as the silver foliage stackies, but if you grow that, you know that, like all silver foliage plants, winter drainage is really important if you want it to come back next year. These green foliage forms are far more forgiving, again, about soils. They'll grow and do nice displays in full sun or light shade. And look at this great, great foliage on this highly rugose foliage. The venation pattern stands out beautifully. And some air verticality to it. All of them tend to do that. This is one called Hibello. Probably 24 or 30 inches or so in height on that one. Similar here with this one. This is one called Pink Cotton Candy. Great name once again. And look at the show flowers on this thing. Actually, it came out of the Chicago Botanic Garden once again. Another introduction that came out of there. This wonderful, wonderful show of pink flowers here, backed up with some echinacea in the background there. So you really, if you haven't tried these, you really need to, because they're such tremendous plants and bloom for a number of weeks in the summer months. And then when they're done flowering, you get ahead and take all that out. You've got this great carpet of foliage there for the rest of the season. Actually, it's another plant that could function as a very effective living mulch or ground cover in the garden as well. Polygonatus or solomon seal, there's nothing new about this guy. It's been around for a long time, but again, one of the best shade perennials for us, hands down, is this plant. And blooms in the month of May. A lot of us never even see these when they flower, because the flowers are They're pendant hanging down from the leaf axils down in here. Nice show of fruit color later in the year, kind of purplish black fruits. Great fall color. Again, turns bright yellow in the fall of the year and has this wonderful arching architectural kind of habit to it as well. So again, just an absolute top-notch performing plant for shady gardens. And then just to tease you a little bit, there's some of this kind of stuff. Look at the difference in the variegation patterns from this one to that one. That one's called double wide. We're seeing lots and lots of great new selections of solomon seal working their way into the trade that really step up the level of variegation over this. Not that I do dislike this, but if you can imagine this clump with that foliage, make a great statement in the shade garden through the whole season as well. So some fun things to work with there as well. Just a couple words about reblooming daylilies. And these are just a couple examples of some of the reblooms. What you always have to remember about rebloom in daylilies is that rebloom in daylilies is dependent upon new plant formation, new ramets. The only way you're going to get more flowers is if a plant is constantly producing new little plantlets. And if you let a rebloom daylily get too congested and too tight, it can never produce the size ramets that it needs to produce flowers. Lesson is, with reblooming daylilies in general need to be divided on a frequent basis if you want them to bloom consistently for the whole summer months. So Stella de Oro is the most well-known. It's probably a much, much overused plant in the landscape situation. Stella often will start flowering for us in the month of May, later part of May. If you got a 10-year-old Stella that is just this tight, tight, congested clump, what it's probably going to do is produce a flush of flowers, rest, produce another flush, rest, produce another flush.
If that implant had been divided at the 3 to 5 year range when it needed to be divided, that implant should produce flowers nonstop from May until frost. So culture, plant management all play a significant role in how rebloom functions in the landscape. So regular division, good fertility, good watering are really keys if you want to maximize rebloom in day bloomers. Do that?
Yeah.
You can get some great stuff out of them. I think the story that really never gets told very well on that group of plants. And not all rebloomers are small flowered. This is ones in the previous slide. This is one called Bodacious Returns, which is probably a 4 or 5 inch size bloom on them as well. You have to be a little bit careful with rebloom in large flowered day lilies. Because most of the breeding work in day lilies is in this country, and it's in southeastern United States. It's in Georgia, it's in Florida, it's in the Carolinas. A lot of day lilies that will rebloom down there will never rebloom for us here because our seasons are too short. So when you're selecting for rebloom, try to select from northern breeders that whose stuff is, you know, has been bred to, you know, genetically bred to rebloom for us here in the Far North. Some of that southern stuff will never do it for us here. But you can find some nice large flowered reblooming day lilies as well. Jill pies. And you know that Jill pies can be huge. Supposedly these little baby Joes and little Joes and phantoms and some of those, I don't know what's happened with that. I think what's happened is that some of those started being, instead of being vegetatively propagated in nursery trays, started to be seed propagated. So a lot of baby Joes and little Joes aren't so little. Some of them that are supposed to be 30 inches are getting to be 3 to 4 feet. They're still shorter than our wild ones that can stand 8 to 10 feet tall. So, but again, late summer bloom, pollinators, gotta have it if you're interested in that, because the butterflies, particularly monarchs, will absolutely go all over this plant to feed on it. Great foliar characteristics, and again, permanence, longevity. We tend to find them, most of those species, native in fairly moist environments. If you look at where they occur, our native ones occur, you'll find them in roadside ditches, wet meadows. They don't necessarily have to have that, but they're very tolerant of that. They'll grow in upland soils really pretty nicely. But if you drought stress them through the hot summer with no water on them, they'll probably scorch underneath the edges. So that even supply of moisture is where you're going to have the best results with them as well. Just a couple words on phlocks. We know we have spring blooming phlocks, and in fact some of them are coming into flower right now. Several in my rock garden that are blooming and just starting to bloom now. So we have that group, and then we also have what we call the standard summer phlocks or paniculata type phlocks that bloom in the summer months. We've also now got some great stuff that fills the gap. And this would be an example. That mini pearl was kind of one of the first ones of those to come out that is not as short as the cushion phlocks, not as tall as the tall garden phlocks, shorter stature, and bloom in between those two. So we don't often think of June as late May into June as a time for taller or upright phlocks. This and a number of others really do that and do it really quite effectively. And so we've got, we're seeing that window of time for bloom in that, particularly with the plant being expanded. And I absolutely love this plant. It's just a phenomenal flock to have in the garden. And there are several others of that similar type that are out there as well. Most people now tend to want to look at tall garden or summer flocks, what we call tall garden flocks or summer flocks. The real interest there now seems to be more on the shorter end of things, trying to get more compact versions of these plants that have good disease resistance and still have a really nice show of flowers. So these are three examples here. These are probably all in the 24 inch tall range, somewhere in that, maybe even a little bit shorter on one of them. But so they're fairly short, compact, summer blooming ones with really good foliage, and that is the bugaboo with tall garden flocks is disease issues with them. So, but in these three series, all these have really good disease-resistant characteristics to them, and as you can see, fairly large heads of flowers on them as well. So we have nice compact plants with a really nice show of flowers, And the Flame series is probably the most well-known of them, and you're just looking at Flame Purple here, but there's a whole range of colors in those as well. So that's where we seem to be doing a lot, where a lot of breeding work has gone within those. And again, part of that's driven by how it looks in the pot. But they're also turning out to be pretty good plants in the landscape. Here's another great native, Prairie Native. Prairie Native for us here, Euphorbia colorata, flowering spurge. It's a good spurge. It's not a bad spurge, it's a great spurge, actually. Looks very much like a baby's breath, and it's, you know, if you garden on a heavy clay soil and try to grow baby's breath, you've probably killed it a few times. In fact, I killed one over the winter, last winter. It's dead as a doornail with a spurge. I don't know why I even tried when I could do this. This is a summer, mid to late summer bloom. These nice show of flowers, probably 2 to 3 feet tall. Really a tough as nails plants. You know, the only negative, if there is a negative, in my mind it's not, but if you want a potential negative with this, is it's not a really tight clumper. It tends to want to be more of a colonizer. In the right situation, I think that can actually be advantageous. So, but it's just another example of a great, great prairie native that obviously will tolerate heat, drought, all those difficult kind of growing conditions and give us good results. Has great fall color to it as well. Wine purple fall foliage coloration to it. So, penstemons. You gotta be careful again. Southwestern U.S. native penstemons in our soils are destined to failure. The ones we do best with are ones that have penstemon digitalis in the background. Digitalis is a native prairie species for us, and penstemon dark towers would be an example of one that does have digitalis in that. So. This is kind of the next step beyond Husker Red, the old Husker Red that many of you may grow. It's a better plant than Husker Red. Foliage color holds better, flower show is better, but all the penstemons demand full sun, good drainage. But some of them are just not going to be here unless we put them into a bright garden situation. But these types, this and Blackbeard and a couple others that are out there in the trade, you'll do just fine with them, give you a really nice show of flowers in the summer. A couple words on bee bombs or Monardas. Whoops, that wasn't supposed to happen. Actually, I'm going to let it go. The one that was in there was raspberry wine. It's a standard old tall variety bee bomb or Monarda. And you know that these are spreaders. These are mints again, but these want to colonize and take over some areas. So that may be good or bad depending upon your situation. What I wanted to point out here was some of the modern ones here. This is a series called Pardon My, and there's a number of different flower colors here. Obviously looking at Pardon My Purple here. And what sets these apart are not as wide-spreading plants, they're more clump formers. They have really nice foliage that is not prone to mildew and some other issues that we find on some of the older varieties of bee balm. And then these nice big showy heads of flowers on them as well. And there are a number of different series of those kinds of bee bombs that are out there. This is probably in the 24 inch tall range, something like that. And you know, some of the standard old varieties can easily get 3-4 feet tall. So you do have a number of great possibilities there as well, some good recent stuff to look at as well. Flowering onions. You guys think about those babies primarily for spring bloom, but there's some great summer blooming stuff. I've grown summer beauty flowers since the 70s. Love the plant, still love it, still a great plant today. Blooms July, August for us here. Great foliar characteristics, nice deep green foliage that persists all summer. Just to show you maybe the next step down the line, some of these kind of things. There's a gentleman in Massachusetts by the name of Mark Madonna who's been breeding with these for a number of times. This is one of his introductions and probably his most widely available one. Look at the great foliage on that. Look at the show of flowers on that. And the bees will absolutely be all over this thing. So there are these non-summer dormant type ornamental onions that I think we've not done a good job of utilizing in our gardens. And just two examples for you here today. Gotta say, mention a couple grasses, because I think they're such an important palette for us here, and we could talk for hours on these as well. This is a big mass planting of a selection of our native prairie drop seed called Tara. And Tara differs from our straight species in that it's more compact in habit, a little bit more upright, and an amazing bloomer. And you can see what it looks like utilized in mass here as well. So many of our native grasses are here. There's some interesting, great selections of some of our native grasses that we need to do a better job with as well. Prairie drop seed, obviously prairie native, loves the heat, loves the drop, loves the abusive kind of conditions. That's what it's going to thrive on, and where it's really where the kinds of situations where it's really destined to be utilized. Get beyond Rebecca Goldstrom, much overutilized plant. And because we've so overutilized it, we run into just a ton of disease problems in Rebecca Goldstrom. If you grow it, you may have experienced that. Very prone to septorial leaf spot. Black lesions eventually coalesce and take over the whole plant. It's the kind of problems we run into when we use too much monocultures. And so my point to you is to look at some others. And I just put one example in here today. This one is not native here in Minnesota. It comes native. As close to us as southeastern Wisconsin, northwestern Illinois. It's a taller upright species called subtomentosa, called sweet black-eyed Susan, because the foliage has a very, if you crush the foliage, it has a very sweet fragrance to it as well. And this is an interesting, this is a quilled selection, quilled petals on it. So it's a really kind of a different look to it than some of the other varieties. And there are some other really good ones out there as well, I think, that we need to look at to get beyond just utilizing old-fashioned culture. One other grass here. This is not a native grass. This is native to Eurasia. Silver spike grass, what do you call that? Silver spike grass, or sometimes called frost grass. This is not a grass that you grow for winter interest. This is a grass you would grow for summer interest. It almost has a bamboo look kind of foliage to that, real horizontal foliage. And then late summer, we get these dramatic spires of flowers that come up. But when the first snow comes, this thing crashes to the ground and it's done. So this is not a grass that we look to for winter interest, but in the summer landscape, it's a great plant. It's absolutely hardy as nails. Will live for decades and decades and decades. So it's if you haven't tried that one, it's worth trying. There's nothing difficult about growing it. Balloon flower, I had to include balloon flower because it's a late summer plant, and we don't utilize this plant enough. Again, if we're looking for that permanence and longevity in a plant that we can put there and be there 20 years down the line, the balloon flowers certainly fit the bill on that. And again, you can go from very short, more pot types that are 10, 12 inches tall to the standard species that will probably be 2 to 3 feet in height. And again, blues, pinks, purples and whites can be the predominant colors. But for late summer, this is a very significant, very important group of plants with great foliar characteristics and good fall color to the foliage as well. One other grass, and I just put this in because we have talked a little bit about Miscanthus. Of course, this is the genus that everybody gravitates to for winter interest in the landscape. If you follow this at all, you know that Miscanthus in general has become a very, very, very serious invasive problem in eastern, southeastern United States, where it has totally taken over wetlands and crowded out all the native vegetation. Can or will that ever happen in Minnesota? I don't know. Many of the Miscanthus are not reliably hardy for us here, so that's going to eliminate a number of them right away. If you want to grow any of them, I certainly think that old-fashioned purpurescence is probably the best. It does not seem to produce a lot of viable seed to it. Not to say that you won't see seedlings off of it, but it's not a strong self-seeder as some of the other ones are, and it is absolutely the hardiest Miscanthus for us here. Beyond that, of the hundreds of other cultivars that are out there, most of them are either not winter hardy for us here, or they flower too late to be of value for us here. So certainly we would concentrate our selections on that particular one. Here's another example of an herbaceous plant that can be utilized like a shrub. This is one plant. This is Persicaria polymorpha, or the giant fleece flower. Used to be one of the polygonums. That genus is now gone and switched over to this. But this is not a running plant. This is a clump-forming plant. And blooms for practically the whole summer. tough, tough as nails. You cannot kill this thing. In fact, if you ever tried to divide it, it has roots like this on it. It's absolutely massive. So choose this planting location carefully, but it really, for all practical purposes, here at the front of this structure, it functions like a woody plant, but it is totally herbaceous in nature. It dies to the ground in the fall of the year. And not commonly seen around here, but really is a pretty good plant. And then I just, to kind of wrap up here, I just want to run through just a couple of things in sedum. We know this genus is important for us for the latter part of summer and into the fall months. This is, if you grow Autumn Joy, throw it out, put this one in. This is a much better plant. This is one called On Fire. So we can go in these sedums, we can go from upright forms to ground cover forms. We're obviously looking at an upright form here. We can get some interesting foliage colors on them. This is Maestro early in the season, and then Maestro mutes down, foliage mutes down a little bit by the time it flowers in the fall of the year. But again, tall, upright kind of form to it as well. We have some interesting mid-sized ones, and that is a true flower color. This is Mr. Goodbud. Mr. Goodbud's probably 16, 18 inches tall max. And so many of those kinds of sedums at that height are real floppy in nature. They have really poor stem strength. This one's very good. Stands up very nicely on its own. It's got a tremendous flower color on it. And then just wanted to mention this series. This is more ground cover kind of sedum. This is one of a number of introductions from Chris Hansen in his Sun Sparkler series. And what sets these out as ground cover plants from many of the other more common sedums are really much more interesting foliage colorations. They aren't all this color. There's a whole range of foliage color types that are out there. And in his breeding work, he was trying to breed large-headed ground cover sedums. So these, a bloom head on this can easily probably be 6 to 8 inches across. What that translates to you in terms of the landscape, if you use that as a ground cover mass, is that when it's in flower, you do not see anything but flower. You see no foliage whatsoever. So I have great, great flower coverage on them. So, and as I say, Chris has probably got 6 or 8 varieties in that series now. So that's a really good group of plants, sedums for ground covers. And then we have to mention this grass because every Minnesotan should be doing this one. Mary Meyer's Blue Heaven. Mary's work, her PhD work, when she was doing her PhD work here in Minnesota. This is a really the best little blue stem for us here, and it stands out from the others because it tends to be more vertical, upright in habit, has tremendous fall color to it. Magenta purple fall coloration to it that's absolutely wonderful. So if you don't grow Blue Heaven, you really must, because it helps support the breeding program. And then the last picture here, is another one that is not by any stretch of the imagination new, but we don't do a really good job of utilizing the monk's foots. These are delphinium relatives, but these are far more permanent plants on the landscape than any delphinium ever will be. So when they're planted and happy, they will last for decades and decades and decades. And so most of these are late summer fall bloomers. There are also, however, some monk's foots that bloom in the summer months that are winter hardy for us here. They tend to have a vertical, upright kind of habit to them once again. And, you know, as I say, if we're looking for workhorses and those kind of plants that will be with us long term, certainly the monk's hoods fill that bill as well. So that, in a matter of a little over an hour, is kind of a run through of some of the possibilities. This, as I say, we didn't touch on a lot of great plants here tonight. Some of your favorites I may have left out as well. So.